Hello students, so today's session is about skeletal muscle relaxants, and this is the first part of the skeletal muscle relaxants. So we'll be learning the classification of skeletal muscle relaxants, and we'll be looking into the pharmacology of neuromuscular blockers, which are a type of skeletal muscle relaxants. So in this part one, we shall be covering up to the pharmacokinetics of the neuromuscular blockers. So what are these drugs? Skeletal muscle relaxants are the drugs which are used to reduce the muscle tone or to cause the paralysis of the muscles. Now, where do you require to reduce the muscle tone or to induce a paralysis of the muscles? Or where do you want the muscles, skeletal muscles, to relax? So the general uses are along with general anesthetics to provide muscle relaxation during the surgery. So all of you know that the patient has to be immobile during the surgery, and hence you require to produce skeletal muscle relaxation. So the SMRs are used during surgery along with the general anesthetics. These are also used for cutting painful muscle spasms. So you might be knowing about torticollis, that is the painful neck spasm, or the lumbago, that is back spasm. To cut off, during these spasm, the muscle is highly contracted. So you want to decrease the contraction or you want to relax the muscles. So these are also used during these painful muscle spastic conditions, and also in spastic neurological conditions like upper motor neuron palsy. So UMN palsy also, it is used where the muscles are highly contracted. To cut off the spasm of the muscles, these skeletal muscle relaxants can be used. These are the two principal uses of SMRs. There are other uses also, but these are the principal two uses of SMR. Now, what are the sites of action of the skeletal muscle relaxants? The SMR can act either centrally through the cerebrospinal axis, or they can act peripherally. Now, the drugs which are acting peripherally, they can act either at the neuromuscular junction, that is the junction of the nerve and the skeletal muscle. So the junction of both of these neuromuscular junction, it can act. So all of you, I think we have already discussed when we were studying cholinergic class drugs, we have discussed the type of receptors which are present on the skeletal muscle end plate. And these were NM receptors, NM. So principally these drugs will be blocking those NM receptors. Neuromuscular blockers will be blocking the NM receptors, which are present on the skeletal muscle motor end plate. But there are other class of peripherally acting drugs which can act directly on the muscle. They are not acting on the NM junction. They are acting directly on the muscle and producing the muscle relaxation. So they, once again, they can act either centrally or they can act peripherally. Among the peripherally acting skeletal muscle relaxants, they can act either at the neuromuscular junction or they can act directly on the skeletal muscle fibers. Now let us look at the classification of SMR. The SMR classification is also based on the site of action. As you can already see, they are classified into peripherally acting or centrally acting. So centrally acting, the sub-classification I have not shown here. We'll be taking up the centrally acting in detail in the next part of the class. So here I'm only elaborating on the peripherally acting skeletal muscle relaxants. So as I told you, they can be either neuromuscular blockers, which are acting on the neuromuscular junctions, or they can be drugs which are directly acting on the skeletal muscle fiber. So the examples of the drugs directly acting on the skeletal muscle fibers are dandrolene sodium and quinine. Quinine is one drug which is used for malaria also, but it is also a directly acting skeletal muscle relaxant. Now let us look at the neuromuscular blockers in detail, because this is the one area that we are going to discuss in detail in this part of the class. So the neuromuscular blockers, they can be divided into non-depolarizing or competitive blockers, and the other one is depolarizing blockers. So first one is non-depolarizing blockers or competitive blockers, and the other one is depolarizing blockers. Now, based on the duration of action, the non-depolarizing or the competitive blockers can be further divided into long-acting neuromuscular blockers, example, D-tubocurarin, pancuronium, doxycurium, pipecuronium, intermediate-acting vecuronium, atracurium, cisatracurium, rocuronium, rapacuronium, and the shortest acting one is mivacurium. So you have to remember the examples of the drugs under each of these. Under the depolarizing blockers, you have examples of succinylcholine and dexamethasone. So now we are going to take up the non-depolarizing or the competitive blockers in detail. So the first one, we'll see about the history of the neuromuscular blockers. So this figure or this picture might be familiar to at least some of them, some of you people. That is, you can see a tribal who is hitting an arrow to hunt animals. And this arrow is actually poisoned with a poison. And as soon as the arrow hits the animal becomes paralyzed. And these plant extracts, which were used to smear the arrows, were called as curare. And they were used by South American tribals to poison the arrow. And this was used to paralyze the animals. So the muscle paralyzing active principle of curare was found to be tubocurarin. So from this, the use of this poison or the arrow poison, the neuromuscular blockers were developed. This gave the hint for the developing of neuromuscular blockers, because neuromuscular blockers are also paralyzing the skeletal muscle, and this the active principle that these people used was tubocurarin. So tubocurarin was first clinically used as a skeletal muscle relaxant in 1930s, and a further synthetic compounds were later introduced. So all the examples that you saw, pancuronium, doxycurium, all these were subsequently introduced in the next years. Now we'll see the mechanism of action of neuromuscular blockers. This is very, very important. You should know the mechanism of action of both the non-depolarizing or the competitive blockers as well as the depolarizing blockers. Now, before we go into the mechanism of action, you all know how the skeletal muscle contraction occurs. When you were learning the cholinergic system, we had learned that as acetylcholine is released from the motor nerve endings, acetylcholine goes and binds to the NM receptors present on the skeletal muscle end plate and brings about the contraction of the skeletal muscle. So this is how it occurs. So the acetylcholine has to bind to the NM receptors to bring about the skeletal muscle contraction. This is a basic thing that you have to remember before we learn the mechanism of action of neuromuscular blockers. Now, the site of action of both the non-depolarizing and depolarizing blockers is on the NM receptors present on the skeletal muscle fibers, which I already told you that they are acting on the NM receptors. Now, we'll see the mechanism of action of the first one, that is the non-depolarizing or the competitive blockers. Now, as the name suggests, competitive, they are competing with the acetylcholine. So the acetylcholine is the natural substrate, natural transmitter, which is binding to the NM receptor to bring about the contraction of the muscles. Now, these blockers are competing with the acetylcholine to bind to the NM receptors. These blockers will compete. So what will happen? These blockers will start to bind with the NM receptors in preference to the acetylcholine. And when these receptors, these blockers are pure antagonists. They don't have any intrinsic activity of their own. They will just go and block the receptors. They cannot induce their own changes. They will just block the receptor. As a result, what will happen? Once these are blocking the receptors, what will happen? The acetylcholine, which is released from the motor nerve endings, is not able to bind with the receptors. And hence, the muscle contraction will not occur. So this is how the muscle contraction will be blocked by the non-depolarizing neuromuscular blockers. Now, how can you reverse the action of non-depolarizing blockers? So this is the way by which they are producing the relaxation or blocking the contraction of the skeletal muscle relaxing. Now, is there a way by which you can reverse the blockade that has been produced by the neuromuscular blocker? What can you do? You can give anticholinesterases. Anticholinesterases are drugs which inhibit the cholinesterase enzyme, and they will increase the concentration of acetylcholine. So once the concentration of the natural transmitter is increased, they can push off the blocker and reverse the relaxation that was produced by the neuromuscular blocker. So under this slide, you need to learn two things. That is how the non-depolarizing neuromuscular blockers have brought about the blockade of the contraction, and also how that block can be reversed. The block can be reversed by anticholinesterases. Now we'll see the mechanism of action of depolarizing blockers. So the example of depolarizing blockers which I gave was succinylcholine and decamethonium. So we'll be seeing succinylcholine. So succinylcholine, it has got affinity as well as submaximal intrinsic activity at the NM cholinoreceptors. That means, unlike the non-depolarizing blockers, which are just going and having affinity and just going and binding and blocking the receptor, this is going and binding also, as well as it is also having submaximal intrinsic activity. That means it can itself stimulate the receptor to some extent. That is submaximal intrinsic activity. So what will they do? They will depolarize the muscle end plate by opening the sodium channels, just as acetylcholine. So what will they do? They'll bind to the receptors and they will start depolarizing. So when acetylcholine is binding to the NM receptors, they depolarize the muscle end plate or bring about the contraction. The same way the succinylcholine is having some amount of intrinsic activity. So after binding, it will also start contracting the muscles for some time. So first, this skeletal muscle relaxant, that is depolarizing one, will produce initial twitching and fasciculation. That means you will find a rapid contractions in the beginning. So before relaxation occurs in this case, you will find a twitching and fasciculation. This is because they are having some kind of submaximal intrinsic activity, because of which they are stimulating the NM receptors and causing depolarization of the muscle end plate. Now, what happens is that acetylcholine, normally it will act for some time and it will dissociate from the receptor. But this succinylcholine will not dissociate rapidly from the receptor. It will go on inducing the prolonged depolarization of the muscle end plate. So what will happen? The muscle has been now twitching for some time. Now what happens? All the channels will be inactivated. Sodium channels will become inactivated. This is what, like, once you start working for a long time, what happens? If you get fatigued, the same way, because the succinylcholine has depolarized the NM receptors, for a long time, all the sodium channels become inactivated. And because of that, you will get a flaccid paralysis. They are not able to now produce a contraction. It becomes a flaccid paralysis. This is called as a phase 1 block. The phase 1 block is because the sodium channels get inactivated due to prolonged partial depolarization. You have to remember these words. The sodium channels get inactivated because of prolonged partial depolarization. So this is the phase 1 block that is induced by the depolarizing blockers like succinylcholine. They also produce a phase 2 block, which is occurring at high doses of succinylcholine. So what happens after some time? Now the depolarization is going on. After some time, the depolarization decreases and the membrane tries to become repolarized again. Again, when it is trying to become depolarized, it cannot be done because the membrane has become desensitized. This is called as the phase 2 block. So the first phase 1 block was because of the inactivation of the sodium channels. Phase 2 block is because the membrane has become desensitized. The membrane itself has become desensitized, and this is occurring at the higher levels or higher doses of the succinylcholine. Now, this phase 2 block is resembling the block that is produced by the non-depolarizing blockers that we discussed in the previous slide. And this block, that is a phase 2 block of the succinylcholine can be reversed by anticholinesterases. The phase 1 block cannot be reversed by anticholinesterases. Okay, but phase 2 block, which is resembling the phase 1, the block produced by non-depolarizing blockers, can be reversed by anticholinesterases. Now we'll see the actions of the neuromuscular blockers. That is, what is the first action? First action is the skeletal muscle relaxation, and we'll see how, what kind of relaxation it is producing. So we already saw the non-depolarizing blockers like D2-procuraren, pancuronium, they are producing muscle weakness followed by passive paralysis. That is, weakness followed by paralysis. Depolarizing blockers, what did you see? You saw initial twitching and fasciculation. After that, only flaccid paralysis occurred. The non-depolarizing blockers, when they are given, the small or the fast response muscles like the fingers, extraocular muscles, they are affected first. That means they are relaxed first, followed by the hands, feet, leg, trunk, intercostal muscles, diaphragm. Okay, so larger muscles are acting, are responding later on. On the other hand, in the case of depolarizing muscle blockers, first the neck, leg muscles, followed by respiratory muscles. So these are involving the larger muscles earlier as compared to the non-depolarizing blockers, which are involving the smaller muscles initially. The recovery occurs in the case of non-depolarizing or the competitive blockers. The recovery from the paralysis occurs in the reverse sequence. That is, first the diaphragm will recover, then the trunk muscles, then the face muscles, and so on. And their effect usually lasts for 45 minutes to 1 hour. And as I told you, the blockade can be reversed by anticholinesterases. In the other one, you can see the depolarizing blockers, the blockade is lasting less than 10 minutes. The recovery is rapid. So probably when you're using these depolarizing blockers, you will be using them for procedures which are lasting less than 10 minutes or for short procedures, because their action is only 10 minutes. Whereas the long procedures, you can use the non-depolarizing blockers. And as I told you earlier, the depolarizing blockers, only the phase 2 blockade by them can be reversed by anticholinesterases. Now, what are the other actions? So the principal actions I have discussed, that is on the skeletal muscles. Now the other systems, how they are affected by the neuromuscular blockers. On the CVS, so I'm taking D-tobocurarin as the prototype drug of the non-depolarizing blockers, and I'm taking succinylcholine as the prototype drug of the depolarizing blockers. So D-tobocurarin, it produces fall in BP and increased heart rate. Whereas succinylcholine is causing bradycardia initially, but later on it produces tachycardia and rise in BP. GIT, the non-depolarizing blockers, they cause post-operative paralytic ileus. That is, they will cause the paralysis of the rectus abdominis muscle, and this can often result in constipation. Neuromuscular blockers do not cross the blood-brain barrier and then hence do not have any central effect. So here you have to probably remember the actions mainly on the CVS and on the GIT. Now, the advantages of newer neuromuscular blockers over the older ones like D-tobocurarin. So I mentioned that D-tobocurarin was one of the first neuromuscular blockers, and later on various synthetic compounds like pancuronium, doxycycline, etc. were synthesized. Now, these were having more advantages than D-tobocurarin. So already you saw the effects of serious effects of D-tobocurarin. And they also had, the D-tobocurarin also had some unwanted effects. That is, it could cause histamine release and allergic reactions and all. Now, these were not seen in the newer neuromuscular blockers that were developed in the next years. So the newer ones did not have much of a cardiovascular effect. They did not have much of histamine releasing effect. And many of them were short acting and easy reversal was done. What does it mean? It means that I showed you D-tobocurarin, which almost acting like long-acting ones. It is almost acting like 45 minutes to 1 hour. So what happens is that if you want to reverse the blockade. So you might have to give an anticholinesterase to the patient. If you want the reversal to occur before 1 hour, you might have to give an anticholinesterase to bring back the skeletal muscle to the normal condition. Now, the subsequent, the newer ones are somewhat lesser than acting. They are not that long acting as dipivacaine, so they might not be requiring a reversal. Means you don't require an agent to reverse their action. Some are like very rapid acting, like mivacurium, etracurium. These are very rapid acting, and they can be even used as an alternative to succinylcholine. So succinylcholine was a depolarizing blocker which is acting for 10 minutes. So on non-depolarizing blockers also, the newer ones that were developed were having some very short acting ones were there, which could be used as an alternative to succinylcholine also. Now we'll see the pharmacokinetics of neuromuscular blockers. So these are not given orally. They are all given by the parenteral route, either by the IV route or by the IM route. And as I already told you, they do not penetrate the blood-brain barrier. They don't penetrate the placenta also. Now we look at the non-depolarizing blockers. So in the initial classification, I told you that the duration, based on the duration of action, they are classified into long-acting, intermediate-acting, and the short-acting ones. And why this difference in the duration of action? This is mainly based on their elimination T-half, that is based on their metabolism and excretion. So you can see the drugs which are metabolized in the plasma or the liver, they have got shorter T-half and shorter duration of action, like 20 to 40 minutes. And under these, you have got vecuronium, all these intermediate acting ones like vecuronium, etracurium, cisetracurium, mivacurium, and so on. The drugs which are excreted by the kidney have longer T-half, that is more than 60 minutes. That is, example is pancuronium, dipivacaine, doxycycline. So the longer acting ones, they are mainly excreted by the kidney. As a shorter acting one and the intermediate acting ones, they are metabolized in the liver or the plasma. This is the basis why they are having difference in the T-half and the duration of action. So among the non-depolarizing blockers also, so the shorter acting one and the intermediate acting ones, they will be acting for 20 to 40 minutes, and they will not require an agent to reverse their action, because after 20 to 40 minutes their action will be reversed. But the drugs that is longer acting depolarizing blockers may require reversal using an agent like anticholinesterases. Now we'll see the depolarizing blockers, the mechanism, the pharmacokinetics. Succinylcholine is hydrolyzed by an enzyme that is called as plasma pseudocholinesterases. This is very important. It is often asked in question paper also. So plasma pseudocholinesterases, and its action is lasting up to 5 to 8 minutes. So what happens is that there are some patients who have atypical pseudocholinesterase. Atypical pseudocholinesterase. That is, the pseudocholinesterase might not be having proper affinity for succinylcholine, or they may be having a deficiency of pseudocholinesterase. So patients who are having either atypical pseudocholinesterase or a deficiency of pseudocholinesterase, they can develop prolonged neuromuscular blockade due to succinylcholine. And this prolonged neuromuscular blockade can result in diaphragm paralysis and apnea, which can last for 4 to 6 hours. And this is called as succinylcholine apnea. Now, what does it mean actually, this one? This means that the succinylcholine action is acting only for, is for 5 to 8 minutes. Why? Because it is getting metabolized by the plasma pseudocholinesterase. Now, the patients who are having atypical pseudocholinesterase or no pseudocholinesterase, what will happen in those patients? The succinylcholine will not be metabolized adequately. Hence, the succinylcholine will go on acting for a long time. And because of that, it can lead to diaphragm paralysis, because it will go on persisting. As I already told you, the larger muscles are involved in succinylcholine. So if it is acting beyond 8 minutes for a long time because of the lack of metabolism, then this can lead to the diaphragm paralysis, and it can lead to apnea. And this apnea, how do you treat the apnea? This apnea is occurring because of the lack of metabolism of succinylcholine by the pseudocholinesterase enzyme. Okay, so what can you do? You can treat the patient by mechanical ventilation. Okay, that is what you do for any patient who has got apnea, mechanical ventilation, and you give fresh frozen plasma. Now, why do you give fresh frozen plasma? Because the pseudocholinesterase enzyme is present in the plasma. So, to replenish the fresh the pseudocholinesterase, you are giving the fresh frozen plasma. So, by giving the fresh frozen plasma, you are providing the patient with more pseudocholinesterase enzyme, which will go and metabolize the succinylcholine. So, I have not written it here, but you have to mention it in your answers. Whenever you are writing about succinylcholine apnea and the treatment for it, you have to mention why the fresh frozen plasma is given. It is given to replenish the pseudocholinesterase enzyme. So with that, we come to the end of the first part. The session will be continued in the second part. Thank you.